Hey, I am so impressed that you guys are here. Isn't it incredible how hard it is to get somewhere by 10:30 a.m. when you stay up past midnight? Like, that's normally, you've been at work for a couple hours, but New Year's Day, 10:30 a.m. is pretty early. Proud of you guys. Like Lane said earlier, we were really expecting no one to be here today, and you guys showed up, so we're super proud of y'all. And we just want to take a second and pray and just dig into God's word today. So you guys bow and pray with me. Father, thank you so much for who you are, God. We just want to take this time to pray over this year, Father. Today's a day just like any other day, but God, it's just kind of a time of reset in our minds. And we pray, Father, that you will just anoint this year and bless this year, Father, and let work be done in this community. Let us begin to reach those children that you love who are far from you. And let us, who are children that you love, just get closer and closer to you, Father. And it's in your name that we pray and we ask all this. Amen. Awesome. Okay, you guys, we are, Dusty, I don't have a stand. This was a major oversight. You guys changed up your stands and now I don't have anything. It's coming. Okay. Awesome. Thank you so much. Look at that. Perfect. We're good now. Okay, now we can go. You guys, turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 8. If you don't have a Bible, when you come through the door, when you go out those doors, right there are Bibles. They look just like this. Those are a gift to you. It is not a burden for you to take one. Please, please, please take one. It would be our honor for you to take it. If you're not familiar with it, the Bible is broken up into two sections. There's the Old Testament, which is the record of the movement of God, of his creation and choosing his people, and the promise of one day there will be a Messiah. And then the last, like, third of the Bible is the New Testament, and that is where that Messiah, Jesus, comes, and he changes everything. And he is merciful, and he is a God that gives second chances. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. So if you guys go to Luke chapter 8, now I'll visit some other scriptures, I'll let you know about those, but everything will be on the screen to make things easier for you guys so you're not having to play Bible drill out there. So it is the first day, it is January the 1, okay, 2017. So we're talking about this in a timely manner because many of you guys make New Year's resolutions. Anybody out there have a New Year's resolution? Come on. You guys gave up on that already? Like, I've failed that so many times. Why set myself up, right? I did it this year, okay? I've got a resolution, and I'm gonna hit it. I'm gonna make it. So, I was inspired to talk about this weeks and weeks ago when Jerry, who's sitting back here, came up, and he and I had talked, and he said, you know what, the Holy Spirit has come in, and my heart has just been set on fire for God. He said, I need to get rebaptized. No, I don't know what I need to do, but he came up before you guys, and he dedicated his life, and the words he used was, I just asked God for a redo. And I thought, oh man, that's powerful, because how many of us are like, Lord, can I get a redo? Can I get a mulligan on that shot? I've done some stuff that just can, let's wipe that one out and just start new, right? So when I'm playing my wife in ping pong and she starts winning, can we just start over? Right? I need a redo. So God is the God of redos, luckily, all right? And we all get a redo. So we get a redo personally. And we get to tell our friends, family, neighbors, our community that they get a redo, okay? God has given me a redo, and so I want to talk about this. So I'm going to go through this kind of as a, well, here's my inspiration. I was on a ski trip one time, and I was serving at a church, and my pastor and associate pastor from that church were on the ski trip with us. There was a bunch of us. There was about 100 of us on the ski trip. And so my pastor and the assistant pastor were both ex-drug addicts. And one of the guys that we were skiing with, The snowboarder comes up and says, "Hey man, you want to try my manna bread? I just made this last night." And he was dumb enough to take it, and it was laced with ecstasy. And so we go back to our condo, and he's tripping out. We can't figure out what was wrong. And he said, "I don't know, ever since I ate that manna bread," we're like, "You ate the bread from that guy, you know?" And so we finally figured out what happened. And so the pastor comes in, and he says, "Oh, I've done this before. Here's what's going to happen." And he told him every emotion and thing that he would go through before he went through it. And the associate pastor walked in, he's like, "He took ecstasy." He's like, "Oh, is he seeing stuff yet?" You know, just like, they came in, they knew all the steps, right? And so this is kind of my inspiration. That's how we're going to go through this redo. And many of you have had this, or you're going through this, or you know, you're like, I need a re-redo. Can you get like a re-re? Or at this point, I'm on like a re-re-redo, or a redo to the fifth power, whatever, you know? And let's look at that and kind of run through it in that manner. Now, I'm going to tell you that on the do-over, on the redo, do-over, is that what you said, Jerry? Do-over, not redo, do-over. Okay, on a do-over, on a redo, the first thing that you've got to understand is that you need a Savior. Number one, if you want a do-over, you've got to admit that you need a Savior. I don't know if anyone has lived past the age of about 6 months or not, and realize that you're not strong enough sometimes to overcome situations, or to get out of situations, or to turn down temptation. But we all fail. The one thing all of us have in common is that we sin. I don't care what you look like, how much money you make, where you were born, come from a good family, bad family, not a family. Don't care. You sin. It's wired in you somewhere. It's just part of our flesh. Okay? And so we need a Savior. Because God is very holy. And He is, holy means He is set above, set apart. Okay? So He is above sin. Literally, it's beneath Him. You know, we look at each other like, "Oh, you think you're so above me." God is above you in all sorts of manners. But God is above you. And so sin actually separates us from God. So we need a Savior to get us back to God, right? So we need a Savior. And that is step one, is admitting that you need a Savior. Now, once you get past that point, I want to jump in and follow two storylines of some guys that got a do-over. And you can just kind of follow those. First of all, I'm going to tell you the story about one guy. His name was Zacchaeus, and he was a head tax collector. Now, tax collectors, back in the day of Jesus, okay, now he did not live in Jerusalem, he lived in Jericho, which was close to Jerusalem. So in Jericho, in the day of Jesus, tax collectors were notoriously crooked, okay? And so people hated tax collectors. Think of it like this. How do you feel about the IRS? Okay, yeah. So even more so, because they knew, you know, they could count. Well, this is how much too much they took from me, you know. I mean, there was no checks and balance, no system. And so tax collectors were really, really hated people. Zacchaeus was a head tax collector, okay? So this is Zacchaeus, and he was a very small man. He was small in stature. He was a short man. Well, Zacchaeus was much what everyone thought he was as a hated man. He was crooked. Well, Jesus was coming into Jericho one day, was passing through. Zacchaeus heard that Jesus was coming in. And when Jesus came, it was a big deal, and he drew a crowd, right? So Zacchaeus couldn't see over the crowd. And so he runs. Now you can see this really wealthy man just running down the street. And he hits a sycamore tree. So sycamores had kind of, they branch out pretty low, so it would have been easy for him to climb. So he runs, jumps into a sycamore tree, and climbs up the tree just so he can see Jesus. Now Jesus walks through, and he looks up at Zacchaeus, and he says, "Zacchaeus," now how did he know Zacchaeus' name, right? This is just from the Holy Spirit. So he looks up and he says, "Zacchaeus, come down, I want to go to your house. I need to stay at your house today." Okay? And so everybody, of course, throws a fit that he's hanging out with a tax collector. Bada boom, bada bing, there's the story of Zacchaeus. Now, second guy, you go, "I don't relate to Zacchaeus because I don't have the money thing." I can be the jerk part pretty well, but I don't have the money thing going. But a lot of us, we kind of relate to him, we understand. Zacchaeus kind of looks like he's got everything going. So from the outside, it looks like everything is going for him, but for some reason, he needed to climb a tree and see Jesus, right? He needed a savior. And a second guy, Jesus gets into a boat with his disciples, and he goes across the Sea of Galilee. And when they cross the sea, because he traveled all over spreading his message, he crosses the sea, and there's a man there, okay? Now, in three of the Gospels, I don't know if you guys know this, but Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the first four books of the New Testament are all the exact same thing. They're all eyewitness accounts of the life of Jesus. Now, three of them have this story, and one of them says two men, one of them says one man. But when Jesus goes across the Sea of Galilee, he arrives on this new shore, and this man is there. And, I mean, picture this. He's crazy. He's an absolute lunatic. He's got sores all over himself because he cuts himself. They try to come and capture him from time to time, and they'll chain him up, and he snaps the chains, and he's butt naked, running around in the hills, in the tombs. He's in a cemetery, naked, running around crazy. Okay? You're like, this is my neighbor. Sure, this is not an eyewitness account of my street, right? But imagine this, right? So you have Zacchaeus, who looks like he's got kind of everything going for him, and then you got this guy, and he's like, that's bad. Sadly, we relate to the naked crazy guy more often than Zacchaeus, okay? I know I do. Yeah. But here you have this man, and now it's obvious to him. See, and no one looks at Zacchaeus and goes, this man needs a savior, because he's rich. But this guy who has nothing, everybody, you know, we can look at him and say, hey, he needs a savior. So he runs up to the boat when he sees Jesus, and why does he run up to the boat? I don't know. And you find out that the man is demon-possessed. But not only is he possessed by a demon, he's possessed by many demons. And Jesus cast out those demons into a herd of pigs, and the herd of pigs runs off a cliff into the ocean, and they all die. The villagers come up, they're freaked out, and they ask Jesus to leave. Okay? So there's our two stories. You've got a brief synopsis of our two storylines that we're going to follow. Luke chapter 8 is the storyline of the crazy guy, so you know Zacchaeus. We're going to kind of parallel these the whole time, but know that step number one is to admit that we need a savior. Now, in the New Testament, there are 27 books, 13, maybe 14, we don't know who wrote the book of Hebrews, of those books. It was written by a man named Paul. We call him the Apostle Paul. So, Paul related to the crazy naked guy, and we do too. And this is what he wrote, okay, in chapter 7. Romans chapter 7. Okay. So the trouble is not with the law, for it is spiritual and good. The trouble is with me, for I am all too human, a slave to sin. I don't really understand myself, for I want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Anybody feel that one in your soul? Okay. But I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. Can anybody in here say, at any point, I do what I hate. I don't know why I do it, but I hate it and I do it.
Amen.
Okay, let's keep going. But if I know that what I am doing is wrong, this shows that I agree that the law is good. So I am not the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. Anybody tracking with Paul so far? And I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. Have you ever felt that before? Nothing good in my sinful nature. Nothing good lives in me. Okay? I want to do what is right, but I can't. This is hitting home. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyways. And then he closes with verse 20. But if I do what I don't want to do, I'm not really the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. So we all agree we need a Savior because sin is living in us. There's no other explanation. I hate this, but I do it. I want to do this, but I do what I hate. And I've done that for a long time, right? I need a do-over. You gotta sound like you're from Brooklyn when you say that. I don't know. It's a do-over. I don't know. So I need a do-over. I gotta realize that I need a savior, right? For me to have a do-over, for me to have a redo. And then the next thing that's gonna happen is Jesus shows up. Now you're like, whoa, this is not a step. I need steps that I can follow. I can't make Jesus show up. I know. This is the good part. Everybody that we read about, everybody that I'm looking at, Jesus shows up. Like, we don't know how it happens, but Jesus intervenes somehow. I have to get to the point where I say, God, I need you. And then he shows up. Okay? And here's the cool part. You're not supposed to make that happen. Right? That's where love comes in, because he cares about you so much. He's there with you when you say, God, I need you. Help me. I'm dying here. And then Jesus shows up. Zacchaeus had a hole, man. It looked like everything was going right. But then Jesus comes through town. And we'll find out what he does with that later. But you have this crazy man, and he cries out, the Bible says. He's nuts. And then who comes up to shore on a rowboat? Jesus. If you get to the point where you say, God, I need you, Jesus will show up in your life. This is step two, and you don't even have to take the step. He does it. This is one of the cool parts of Christianity, is he takes that step. All we've got to do is realize we need a Savior, okay? Now, step into Luke chapter 8, verse 27. We're following this storyline. Here we go. As Jesus was climbing out of the boat, a man who was possessed by demons came out to meet him. For a long time, he had been homeless and naked, living in a cemetery outside the town. As soon as he saw Jesus, he shrieked and fell down in front of him. Then he screamed, "Why are you interfering with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? Please, I beg you, don't torture me." It's kind of freaky. Why did he fall down and shriek? You know? Now look back at Zacchaeus. He climbs a tree, and Jesus just approaches him. Zacchaeus, I need to go to your house today, right? And so this is kind of more of a natural flow. We can understand this, but this one, this kind of freaks us out. Understand that at the Woodbridge Church, I believe with all my heart that God exists. And I believe that God exists and that the Bible is his word. And it is true. And the Bible says that God has angels with him in heaven. But some of those angels decided to follow Satan. And so there is Satan. There is God. And I also believe in Satan. And I believe that some angels followed Satan. And so I believe that there are demons. And so sometimes some weird stuff happens. We don't like it. We can't explain it. But it happens. Sometimes it's demonic. Now you have the story of Zacchaeus, and it wasn't demonic. But you have the story of this man running around naked in the cemetery, and it is demonic. Okay? It's hard. We can't always explain it, but we know who is more powerful. Okay? We will see why it is more powerful, but Jesus comes up to this man, and he recognizes that the man is demon-possessed. This has happened to me a few times in life where I realize, whoa, we're dealing with something supernatural here. It's kind of uncomfortable, but it's true, man. This kind of stuff happens. And so Jesus says, "Who are you?" And the demon says, "We are legion, for we are many." And he cast out the demons, right? So the man falls down. Something crazy has happened to him here. Jesus shows up. Okay? Realize that you need a Savior. Whether you look like you've got it all going on the outside, or whether you are demon-possessed, Jesus will show up to rescue you. You just have to realize you need him. Cry out to him, okay? So, where am I? Okay, Zacchaeus, crazy man, good. Now we get to number three. So we realize we need a Savior. Jesus shows up, and this happens. There's opposition. Okay? This is pretty much without fail. When you decide to turn your life over to Christ, something will stand in the way. Sometimes it's you, right? And it's insecurities that we're dealing with in ourselves. Sometimes it's family, it's relationships. Sometimes it comes out of nowhere. Man, I'm getting my life right, I'm coming back to church, and then boom, this health thing hits. Or, man, I just got evicted from my house for no reason. Or, I'm telling you, when we began to meet here, you guys know the story, our church is relatively young. I mean, our first service was in August, so we're really one school semester old. But not long after we started, we began gaining momentum, and people would call me and say, hey, you're never going to guess what happened to me. And I'm like, I won't guess it, but I'll believe it. Just person after person after person, this happened, this happened, this happened. I said, it's going to, okay? It's going to happen. And if you're trying for a do-over, if you want a redo, there will be opposition in your life. Understand, well, let's just go to chapter 8, verse 28. We'll just continue in our story here. Okay, with verse 28. As soon as he saw Jesus, he shrieked and fell down in front of him. Then he screamed, why are you interfering with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? Please, I beg you, don't torture me. So you literally have this man who needs a do-over, who needs a redo, and there is Satan standing in the way, telling Jesus, go away, leave us alone. And you will have that. As our country, listen to me, this is me speaking, okay? I'm not reading right now, but I'm telling you, I believe this to be true. As our country gets further and further and further away from God, you will begin to see more of these things happen. You hear stories of missionaries who go over to a country where there's not a lot of Christianity, and they're like, whoa, these strange things happen. And we're beginning to see those because we don't have saints who are there to recognize quickly, hey, this is something going on from Satan. So, anyways, we begin to see that, and so if you're trying for a do-over, sometimes it may be completely natural, sometimes it may be supernatural, but there will be opposition. For Zacchaeus, it was very natural. Jesus was coming, and he was just too short to see, right? So he found a way. For this man was something supernatural. But understand that there will be opposition. Okay? 1 Peter 5:8 says this. 1 Peter 5:8 says, stay alert, watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. If you will commit, and this is why we give these things away like candy if we can, because if you will commit yourself to Christ, if you will begin to dive into this, it will begin to change your life. And if there truly is an evil one out there prowling like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour, he's going to be ticked off because you will have your life changed. And if you really commit to Christ, everyone around you is going to begin to see that. And Satan does not like that. He will throw out opposition. He'll do it on a personal level. And for Ranger, he'll do it on a community level. We have to see it now, we have to recognize it, and know that it's coming, okay? We've begun to make a big splash in this community. Satan's not happy about that. You have friends who you've invited, and you say, I don't know, they came, but I can't get them to come back. They're under persecution, man. There's opposition. There's been something set in front of them, and guess what? We've got to see them through it. How do you do that? You're going to do that on your knees praying. You're going to do that by calling and checking up on them. You're going to do it with love. You're not going to do it with scolding people. You're not going to do it with hatred. You're not going to guilt trip and condemn people to coming into church. Please, let's not be that people. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Okay. We're going to do it on our knees and with love. There will be opposition. Okay. Now, when that opposition hits, this is good. This is a good explanation, okay? When that opposition hits, we get through it, or we continue to make excuses. When we make excuses, and we're basically denying the call of our Father to get closer to Him, if you do that long enough, God says, you've chosen. And the Bible says that a man becomes void of God. Look at Romans chapter 1:28. You're like, I don't remember that in the scripture. Romans 1:28 says this: since they thought it foolish to acknowledge God, he abandoned them to their foolish thinking and let them do things that should never be done. You've all heard the old scenario, right, that there's really no such thing as cold. There's only the absence of heat, right? I mean, space is cold, and then when you throw in the sun, it warms us, right? Just think about it like that. When people begin, we have a sinful nature, and thank God we have Jesus to bring that sunshine in on us and to bring warmth, and we begin to do good things out of that love that he brings to our hearts. But when you are void of the sun, you get very cold. And you say, man, why can terrible things happen in this world? How could God allow? It's not God doing those things, isn't it man doing those things? And you say, this is disgusting. How could this happen? Because that man is void of God. And where you can go in your mind, physically, when you deny Christ long enough, is a scary, awful place. Maybe you didn't know that scripture was there. Okay, but there will be opposition. Let's jump back on track. Number four. Here's the fourth thing that's going to happen. Jesus is going to show you freedom. Okay? Zacchaeus, up in the tree. He's overcome the opposition. He worked through it, right? Jesus comes into town. He knows he needs a Savior. Jesus points at him and says, I want to eat dinner with you. This isn't supposed to happen. This is freeing for him because he's automatically been accepted. Right? Jesus has shown him that acceptance. I want you to understand that if you are here today, Jesus has shown up in your life. I don't know why you're here. Maybe you were tricked. Somebody said, we're going to the donut shop, and you're like, hey, this is church. For whatever reason, you're here. For whatever reason, you heard about this place. Jesus has shown up. He is calling you. There is opposition. Maybe you haven't faced it yet. Maybe you've already been facing it. Maybe you've worked through it. But Jesus, on the other side, begins to liberate you and show you freedom. It is right here. This is the most freeing book. It is the biggest paradox in life. As you submit yourself to Christ, you become more free. It is almost hard to explain. You just have to experience it for yourself. But the most freeing thing you will ever do is submit yourself to Christ. Okay? It's a Christian paradox, man. But it works 100% of the time. So, we have Jesus showing freedom to Zacchaeus. Look at Luke chapter 8, verse 32 and 33. Oops, I'm in the wrong one. Okay. Luke 8, 32 and 33. Guys, I'm struggling running through the scripture today. There happened to be a large herd of pigs feeding on the hillside nearby, and the demons begged him to let them enter into the pigs. They knew it was coming. They just wanted to pick where they went, right? So Jesus gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the pigs, and the entire herd plunged down the steep hillside into the lake and drowned. Jesus brought freedom. Wasn't demonic for Zacchaeus. It was literally just acceptance because no one liked Zacchaeus. For the crazy guy in the tombs, he was literally freed from demonic possession. Either way, when you work through opposition, you begin to pursue God, he will begin to free you. You say, but man, I've got these financial things and I've got this. My debt, whether it be physical, mental, spiritual, whatever, my debt that I owe, I don't know that anyone could relieve. I don't know that I could ever get help from what I need freed from. Is it part of creation? And go to the one who created it. I bet he can help. Jesus can free you from any debt. He can free you from any chain. The man had been years in the tombs. Crazy. Cutting himself. Crying out. Breaking chains. He was obviously a nuisance because why else would they be chaining the man? How long had he been like this? How long have you needed a do-over? Doesn't matter. He can free you. Once he does, this isn't going to make sense until you experience it. once you experience freedom, step number five is you have to learn to deal with your freedom. Does that make sense? You have to learn to deal with your freedom. Let me explain it. I think everybody's going to get this. When you submit yourself to Christ, some of those old relationships start to say, you're not that fun anymore. You've become a religious nut, right? You're doing things that we all used to make fun of together. You've heard the old saying, misery loves company, right? When Zacchaeus was free, Jesus says, I need to go to your house today. What happened immediately following? Everyone is ticked. Why? Jesus, why would you hang out with that guy? I decided when we moved to Ranger that I didn't care who I had lunch with, dinner with. I don't care if you are somebody that the town doesn't like, somebody that the town sees, oh, you, the pastor should never be with him. And my statement has always been, hey, I saw you hanging out with so-and-so. You should have seen who I was with last week, right? It doesn't matter, man. Jesus went to the crazy naked dude in the tombs. People are going to be jealous. They're going to try to bring you back to where they are. Secretly, there will be a lot of people who do not want to see you succeed. Starting to make sense now, does it? There are people who do not want to see you succeed. So this man, naked, running around the tombs, all the demons are cast out of him, and he's standing there in his right mind. I'm assuming he goes and covers himself somehow. I don't know. But he's in his right mind now, and we've got enough time has passed for people to come check for their pigs. They're like, all my pigs just committed suicide. Run back to the village, right? And all the village comes back, and what do? They stand up and praise God and go, look at what you've done for this guy. This is awesome. He's in his right mind. No. What did they say? You need to leave. People will tell you, get out. Doesn't mean you're doing something wrong. Okay? Understand that opposition will hit. Jesus will free you. And you have to learn to deal with that freedom. Because there will be jealousy over that freedom. Okay? There will be opposition to that freedom. There will be responsibility that comes with your freedom. Okay. And here's the other part. Okay? Let's go here. People don't always want to hear the truth. I know that's kind of an overgrown statement, but let's go to our next slide here on the PowerPoint. And this is good. Luke 8:34. We're past that point. Let's move on. One more again. Okay, there we go. 2 Timothy 4:3 says this, for a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. When you are doing something wrong and you call for advice, you generally call people who you know will feed that fire, right? I don't get a lot of calls going, thinking about committing some domestic violence here, right? Thinking about going over the edge, going on a drinking binge, right? You don't call me. You call your buddy who's an alcoholic, right? Say, man, I'm having problems. We'll come over. We'll have a beer and talk about it. Man, I'm going over the edge. I'm over the edge. We'll come over. We'll go crazy together. We'll go shoot up the town. And we begin to call those people, right? Because we know that they're going to give us the advice that we want to hear. And this is how it's going to go. As you begin to change, you're no longer the person that says, we'll come over and we're inebriated together and all that. You're not that person anymore. You're going to say, hey, man, have you been praying about this? Tell me what your relationship with God is like. Because you know the truth. You know where it lies. And they don't want to hear that truth. And we've all been there before. I've been the guy that doesn't want to hear the truth. And so you got to learn to deal with your freedom, because with your freedom comes responsibility. And as you begin to tell the truth, a lot of people are not going to want to hear that. Being a Christian may cost you some relationships. Promise you it's worth it. But know in advance that it may cost you some relationships. Okay, now, We've got to learn to deal with our freedom. And then lastly, number six, just got to follow Jesus. This is what he wrote for us to do. This is the instruction manual. This is the way to freedom. And God commissions us. So when the man, Luke chapter 8, verse 38 and 39. Let's go there first. So we have Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus goes home. Jesus has dinner with him, and Zacchaeus looks at Jesus and says, I'm going to pay back everybody that I owe. Four times as much as I owe them. If I've ripped them off, I'll give them back times four. Also, half of my possessions, I'm giving over to the poor. Jesus didn't even have to say anything. He just willingly volunteered this. I want to make things right. I want to do the right thing. The crazy guy, you can only imagine his joy. You can only imagine the adornment that he looks through when he sees Jesus. And so he, in his right mind, they tell Jesus to leave. Jesus gets in the boat to leave, and he runs up to the boat and says, let me go with you. And what does Jesus tell him to do? Go back to your people and tell your story. Did you know he told you the same thing? Matthew 18, 28. I know you've probably heard me say this before, but Matthew 8, 28 says this. But when the man left... That's totally wrong. Matthew 18, 28 is the Great Commission and says this. Do what? Okay. Matthew 18, 28 is our Great Commission and says that we are to go into all the world and preach to all the nations, right? You know where you got to go first? Home. The man becomes an evangelist. He was crazy. He got a do-over. And now he goes from doing the wrong thing, doing the bad things, to leading people to Christ. People were jealous of his freedom, but he had a commission. He had to follow Jesus. Jesus said, go back to your village and tell the people about me. That's your commission. I'm going to ask the band to go ahead and come up, and we're going to close. As they're playing, there's some guys going to come up with some baskets, and they're just taking an offering. If you are a Christian here today, that's just part of how we worship, is through giving our tithe. But also, when you came through the door, you were handed a connection card today. And if you would just communicate with us, you say, man, I need to accept Christ. I haven't been baptized. Or just write on there, I've got a prayer request. I need a do-over. I need some help. If you communicate with us on those connection cards, this is a great place. Please drop those in the offering basket as well. But man, in one hand you have Zacchaeus. Looks like he's got everything going. You've got a crazy naked dude running around the tombs on the other hand. We're going to relate to one of those. They both get a do-over, and so do you. So I'm going to pray this morning, and I hope that you guys will ask God to forgive the parts where you need a do-over and just begin to tell him, I need you. I can't get through this alone. I got to have a do-over, and that comes through Jesus because he's the one that shows up. I can't make him. He just does it because he loves me. So let's pray. Father, thank you so much for who you are. Thank you that you are the God of do-overs. God, you love every single person in this place, and every person here is a child of yours. God, I know that you are calling your children in this community back to you. And I pray that we will respond, Father, and not only just reset our hearts and our minds and focus ourselves on you, but Father, that we would take this to the community. This community that is full of people that you love. And we need you to do this, God. We can't even control our own selves, Lord, much less a whole culture, but you can, God, so we just surrender that to you. And be pleased with us, God, as we just continue in worship and we praise you. And don't let us stop here. Holy Spirit, we just invite you to follow us out of this place and be with us all week and just prompt our hearts to follow after you with every opportunity we get. In Jesus' name we pray.